Good evening, everybody. Welcome to our May Benedictine Conversations. Tonight is entitled Saved by Beauty, Honoring the Life and Legacy of Sister Mary Charles McGough. We're really excited to bring this to you tonight, and this is actually our last Benedictine Conversation for the academic year. We'll start back in September, so this is a wonderful way to finish out a beautiful season. And I'd like to just briefly talk about Sister Mary Charles. Sister Mary Charles died in 2007. She was 82 years old and had been a member of the Sisters of St. Scholastica for 61 years. She was a teacher and mentor, and she devoted her life to art and education. And here to talk with us about Sister Mary Charles tonight, if they would come on the screen now, is Sister Lois Eckes and Meridith Schifsky. I'll give them a minute to come on. And Sister Lois, you are muted, so if you could unmute, that'd be great. So Sister Lois, of course, was a member in community with Sister Mary Charles and also a very close friend. So we're grateful that you're here with us tonight. Sister Lois, thank you for being here. And then Meredith, I'm sorry, Sister Lois, we're not hearing you.
Here I am.
There you go. Now we hear you. Thank you. And then we have Meredith Schifsky, who actually learned under Sister Mary Charles, correct? And we'll get to that in a little bit, and also became a very close friend. So we're very grateful that you're here too, Meredith, because of all the work that you did with Sister Mary Charles. So we're going to begin this evening. I would just like to tell all you participants out there that you might want to move your view, which is typically up in the top right corner of the Zoom screen, if you would move it to speaker view, and then it just makes it a little less cluttered on the screen usually for you, because we have a number of PowerPoint slides tonight to share with you some of Sister Mary Charles's work. As we begin tonight, we are going to pray, and we are going to use a prayer that Sister Mary Charles worked on with Meredith. So Meredith, I'm wondering if you can just speak a little bit about this beautiful piece of work, and then Sister Lois will lead us in the prayer.
Yes, Sister Mary Charles came to know Michael Cohen in 1975 through mutual friends in the Jewish community. She was a good friend to the Jewish community. They kept in touch, and in 1996, Michael asked her and I to do a commission of the St. Francis prayer for a belated anniversary gift for his wife, Kathy Cohen. She loved St. Francis.
Hmm.
And so this is a 9 by 13 inch painting that hangs in their home now.
And then you also turn them into a card, correct, that can be purchased at the monastery gift shop. We have a couple of things that will alert all of you to for that. So thank you. Thank you, Meredith. And so Sister Lois, if you would lead us in prayer.
Before I do that, I would just like to point out, I don't remember if you said it or not, Meredith, but Meredith did the calligraphy, and Sister Mary Charles did the illumination, as it were, or the artwork. So it's a precious example of how beautifully they work together in the beautiful work we're going to talk about tonight. So let us pray. Lord, make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. Where there is sadness, let me sow joy. O Divine Master, grant that I may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive. It is in pardoning that we are pardoned. It is in dying that we are born to eternal life. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. Thank you so much. As we begin, I'm just wondering if we can kind of set the context and talk about your relationship to Sister Mary Charles, who I know everyone refers to her as Molly, Sister Molly. So, Sister Lois, what was your relationship? Who was she to you?
Before I answer that, Don, I'd just like to say that I just feel Sister Mary Charles, as we do with all our sisters, they're still with us, even if we've gone on home to God. They are so much part of who we are. As you said, Molly's earthly life with us in community was for 61 years. Mm-hmm. And I was blessed to be a part of her life as a member of our community for 50 of those years. So I just so treasure all of that. She really was truly my beloved sister in community. She was an inspiration. She was a person who always invited me to experience and explore my own creative spirit. She was just so warm and beautiful in every way. In fact, I like to think of her herself as a living icon. For me, she was that. She was a living icon of the divine. She radiated God's love, God's goodness, God's compassion, God's joy, and so much more in her daily life. And I really got to know her quite well when I had the joy of moving over to the barn and becoming, first of all, I was there doing my studies in clinical pastoral education. And then I was asked to be the director of McCabe in 1994. And so I was there until I was elected prioress in 2005. So I really lived with Sister Mary Charles, along with, of course, Sister Terry. And we had a beautiful life together in community. And then, of course, she came back to live at the monastery in her last years before, as she was preparing to go home to God. And that was very tender and precious, because it was that was also while I was prioress. The depth of her spirituality was so evident, and she nurtured it so faithfully in her daily prayer, both personal and also coming over to the chapel at the McCabe and praying with us, morning prayer, evening prayer. She was always there to be part of our life there in our ministry. And she was such a beautiful presence with our guests and with people who would come on retreat. Her artwork evolved. I really saw and believe with all my heart, it evolved from her deep spirit, from her very, very soul. She looked at and she experienced life indeed with a contemplative heart. With a deep-seeing, reverent heart that saw God's face in all creation and in all people. she experienced God as beauty itself. And she lived that belief in her life, in her work. In fact, she was reading John O'Donohue's book, Beauty, in her last months of life here on Earth. She also experienced her, she was so much fun. Oh, we had so much fun together. And her Irish spirit, that warm, beautiful spirit was just so exuded from her.
I think as you're talking here, I'm going to pull up a picture of her so people can see what you're talking about with that lovely spirit, because I think you can see it in this picture.
Amen. Thank you, Don. That's beautiful. Mm-hmm. Yes. Yes, and she always had a very humble spirit. She would ask Sister Terry and I to come up when she was working on a piece up for until she went to Subiaco's studio. Her studio was in the barn where she lived also, and she'd invite us up to give her our opinions, to make suggestions, and she'd do that with other people as well. So she always asked for feedback for her work, and it was always very sincere and very appreciated. As I mentioned, I think she was so warm and welcoming and gracious, and she really had a heart that welcomed and listened to others. And there were many times when people would come to see her whose hearts were broken, and she was there with her listening, tender heart, and she was a real healer. In their lives. Also, one more thing I'll say before we pass it on to Meredith. She was so passionate about peace and justice. She and social justice. In fact, way back, I learned when I was looking over her life, between her junior and senior years, she went down to Alabama to work with the poor. So here she was, that seed of commitment and passion for justice and for peace and for reconciliation was in her beautiful heart way back. And Steve O'Neill, who was a dear friend of hers, he would say that she brought a spirit of love, of humanism, commitment, and nonviolence to every public demonstration.
Wow.
And he would always remember times when she'd be down when we have a demonstration at the courthouse or at City Hall. She'd be there with her bouquet of wild daisies that she had picked around the neighborhood or up here at the monastery. She'd be passing out daisies to everybody as a sign of peace and well-being. Yeah. So there's so much more, but that's a good start.
Yeah. Could you give us the context of this picture here? Where was this picture taken?
This is down at the Subiaco studio that she moved to later on. I think maybe Meredith is going to talk about that. Because after a while, her commissions were so big that she couldn't do many more up in the little space she had in the barn. So she got Subiaco was at St. Anthony's, it was a former St. Anthony's school, and actually she had taught there. In fact, if I'm not wrong, the studio was actually a classroom where she had taught when she taught there. Yeah, right. So you see all surrounded by all the icons, and look at, there's Molly, there's Mary Charles herself, a living icon, radiating the divine from the God who dwells within and emanating that light out into the world, into each face that she gazed upon and that gazed upon.
Beautiful, beautiful. Thank you. Thank you for that. Thank you for getting us started. Meredith, I want to hear a little bit about who she was to you. What was she like? How did you interact with her?
I first met her at the beginning of her barn program with Joel Rosenschwag, helped her start. He was her go-to man and helped her put that barn together for her classes.
Just to clarify for people what the barn is, if you could just describe that for a minute.
Well, correct me, Sister Lois, if I'm wrong, but I do think it was the barn on the McCabe property.
Right. It was actually it was the let's see, what was it called on the McCabe family there? They didn't call it the barn. It was the house where they kept their hay there. They have a couple animals there. They have their carriage there. But
like actually, a carriage house. Almost like a carriage house.
Yeah. Carriage house. Thank you. Yeah. Yeah, thank you. But actually, it was the children in the barn program that gave it that name.
Oh. But it got renovated, and then you lived there with Sister Terry and Sister Mary Charles. Okay.
Now that story real quick is 1967, she got the blessing of the prioress to move over there to focus on art. And that's another whole story, how that all happened. But Joe Rosenzweig and others were very instrumental in helping her convert that carriage house into her dwelling place and into her art studio. Yeah. Anyhow, there's more we could say about that, but we don't have time, I know.
So go ahead, Meredith.
Yes, well, thank you for the beautiful memories of her, Sister Lois. And I could recount many similar ones. But after I met her at the beginning of the barn program, then many years later, in 1988, she invited me to collaborate with her on calligraphing and illuminating the Holy Rule.
Which we'll be talking about in just a few minutes and showing you some slides from that. But go ahead, Meredith.
Yeah. So she was a dear friend. She was a mentor. She was a loving but determined teacher. Kept us on track.
You had a story about that. Why don't you share that story with us? When you got too chatty?
Oh, yes. Well, in the icon studio, I mean, I believe that iconography for her was a spiritual practice. Mm-hmm. She learned it as such, and she brought that into the classroom. And she would start our classes with prayer, lighting a candle. Sometimes she'd play her tin whistle. Mm-hmm. And if not, she had meditative music going, some Orthodox chant or Native American flute, something that was peaceful. Mm-hmm. And encouraged us to create these icons of beauty in an atmosphere of peace and prayer. Mm. Yes. And if we got too chatty during the class, she would come around and hush us up and say, now remember, this is to be prayerful. So she really brought that spirit, that inner spirit of her contemplative spirit into the classroom and taught us that we were painting objects that were meant to be a sacred encounter for people. Mm. Iconography.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then I also got to know her, as you said earlier, by collaborating with her on the Holy Rule. And that was 2 years of work. And we can talk about that later. And then I felt like I got to know her even deeper as the six of us as a team worked on putting together the Saved by Beauty book. We shared so many stories and her artwork. So I felt like that gave me a much deeper insight into her.
And that is a book that we'll be talking about later too for all the participants. And this is a book that I want to clarify that was put together after her death. So what I want to do now is I want to read something to you, a quote of hers, and I'd love to get your responses. She said, "I am convinced of the importance of creating beauty, forming it with heart and hand, and offering it to a world possessed with speed, information, and impersonal screen gazing. Perhaps art can help us all to slow down, be silent, and stand in awe before the beauty all around and within us.
I'm so glad that you are sharing that with us, Dawn, because that is a statement that Sister Mary Charles was able to make, and that she believed with all her heart, because her coming to believe that her art was a ministry, it was a process. She didn't feel that way right away. She thought all these people that are out there teaching and that are, you know, that are doing healthcare and bringing healing, and what about me? She thought it was maybe just a little bit too focused on herself and in her, you know, so forth. But she came to realize, as people appreciated what she was doing and were moved deeply to prayer and to relationships with God and with the beauty of their own lives and the beauty of the world through her work. So this is a beautiful statement, how she came to see her beautiful work as truly a ministry. Right, Meredith, would you say that?
Oh, yes, that is such a beautiful quote by her. And related to that, I think that's in her, the chapter she wrote on Saved by Beauty. That was the name of an article she wrote for Sisters Today, Saved by Beauty. And that quote comes from Dostoevsky, the world will be saved by beauty.
Yeah.
And she came to know that, as you said, Sister Lois, it was a process in her life. She didn't realize that at first until she started getting feedback from people on how her art touched them with peace and calm and beauty.
And would you also say that her experience with the Barn program, that was that about 14 years, I think, the Barn program, that she really experienced there working with the children and with the teachers that were part of the faculty for the program, because there was music and science and dance and art and nature study and so forth, that their beautiful lives were just blossoming, and they were coming to know the beauty of God through, and the beauty of creation through what they were doing with her tutelage and with others that were there. So I think the Barn program was truly formative for her, don't you say?
Oh, I think so.
And coming to know her work. In fact, that quote you just shared with us, Dawn, she ends it with a worthy ministry.
And she believes so strongly that each one of us has a creative spark within. And that's what she wanted to ignite in the children she worked with, the adults. That was her encouragement to people. Create art. She did watercolor and wonder workshops, watercolor workshops with adults. That they just blossomed. And she had us writing haiku, poetry.
Wow.
Yeah. So I experienced that through her mentoring of me as we worked on the Holy Rule. I mean, she wanted to encourage the creative spark.
Let's dig into some of her beautiful work. And before I share my screen, I just want to let all the participants know that if you want to send in a question or a comment, please feel free to do it at any time through the chat function. Thank you. And we've spoken several times tonight the project that you worked on, Meredith, with Sister Mary Charles, was to actually, you did the calligraphy and she did the illuminations for the Rule of Benedict, right?
Yes.
Do you want to say anything about how that came to be?
Yes, it was in 1988 when the invitation came from her. And she was a forward-looking woman. She was ahead of her times. And her wish was, or her hope was, that we could do the rule in inclusive language. But as she consulted with her monastery team, it was decided to preserve the integrity of that ancient document, to have it just as it was written. But there's a number of stories here that I loved. In addition to being a collaborator, I also became her student. I learned so much about doing an illuminated manuscript. Mm. Although with her humor, she said to me a couple times, she said, you know, we really don't know quite what we're doing here. We've done this before, but we are going to go ahead and do it. And
I think she paved the way for the monks of St. John's with the St. John's Bible, the two of you did.
That is interesting. And she had, and keep in mind that the Rule of Benedict was done before she went to Ligonier, Pennsylvania to study iconography. So she hadn't really worked with gold leaf, but she was willing to take a risk for the sake of beauty. And she figured out how to include gold leaf in this manuscript. And I just learned so much from her. Can I talk about the colophon page?
That's the end page you're talking about, right?
Yes.
Okay. Somebody has a question. How do you pronounce her last name? I've heard variations and wish to have it accurate. So I can answer that one because Sister Lois taught me. It's Sister Mary Charles McGough, right? Did I say it right, Sister Lois, Meredith? Okay, very good. McGough. Oh.
She would often refer to herself as Molly McGough.
Molly McGough. Do you want to say anything about these pages? The prologue, of course, is the very first page in the rule. And we begin with that famous line, "Listen carefully, my son, to the master's instructions and attend to them with the ear of your heart." So is there anything you want to talk about with these, Meredith?
Well, I was thinking about this and trying to put it together when we would meet together and she would go over the text to be done on the current page we were working on. And then we would talk about, she would say, oh, leave a space here for this illumination or this figure, or leave this here. And then, so I would do the calligraphy and then she would come behind and you could see the embellishment around the prologue, around the picture of the two little monks. So she came behind and did all of that embellishment.
Yeah. Beautiful. We have a message from Dale who says, what a wonderful gathering tonight to remind ourselves of such a gifted and compassionate woman. My young daughter spent many summers hanging on to every word and art teaching of Molly through the summer art program.
Don, before you move on, can I just say something more about the rule before you go to the calendar?
Of course.
I think lots of people know this who are listening tonight, but we have the original copy of our of the rule that Sister Mary Charles and Meredith did, of course, enthroned in our Benedictine devotional area in chapel, which a lot of us are familiar with. But when people would come on retreats or as visitors or whatever, they would say, oh, would you ever think of reproducing this? We would love to have a copy. So the decision was made to reproduce it. And Sister Mary Charles went down to, was it Sheldon?
It was Service Printers at
that time. Service Printers at that time, Meredith. She went down, I talked to them. They said they would do the project. She was there when they ran off the first copy of the original. And she was there for every page to make sure that it was totally accurate and true to the original. So now it's we have it for sale in our gift shop.
Yeah, in the monastery, at the monastery, the gift shop at the monastery, where you can also get those cards with the prayer of St. Francis that they did.
Yeah, and we use the original copy for our own beautiful rituals in chapel. We use it for when a sister moves into a new stage of formation. It's in procession and it's enthroned and the prioress reads from the passage from that rule for that night. And then when a sister dies, the rule is brought in procession and it's laid on her coffin. And or if she's cremated, it's laying on the table beside her picture as a statement about how she has faithfully lived the rule, the life with us of the rule of Saint Benedict. So it's very tender. It doesn't just sit there as a display art piece in a museum. It's part of our rituals.
Yeah. Wonderful. I am very struck with this sunburst here. Do one of you want to say something about it?
Yeah, it's the church. Go ahead, Meredith. Yeah.
No, you go ahead.
No, it's your turn.
Well, I believe this represents the liturgical year in symbols. And just notice how the color fades in and out around it. She just has such a beautiful sense of color, design. This is a beautiful, very beautiful page.
So for those of you who might not be familiar with what we mean by that, we have the Advent season, which would be the purple and kind of the bluish. Then we would have the Christmas season, which is the light. And then we have the Lenten season, more the purple again. And then we have the Easter season and we have Pentecost. Anyhow, it's all the liturgical seasons of the year. Yeah. Advent, Christmas, Epiphany, Lent, Easter, Pentecost, and ordinary time, we say. Yeah.
Thank you. Yeah. And then the final page, if you want to speak to this, Meredith.
I would. the final page of an illuminated manuscript can be a playful thing for the artist to bring the document to conclusion. And this was Molly's interpretation. She painted herself on a stool with her cat below her. And she painted me into the picture on another stool with her dog below her. She loved it.
Could you read it for us, Meredith?
Yes, with gratitude to God and great joy, we bring this work of love to a close on the 30th day of May in the year of our Lord, 1990. 1990. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yes.
So that
I believe it shows her Irish humor.
So that in all things God may be glorified.
And everybody. And the cat's name is Kantiki, or she called him Ticker. And the dog's name is Kasha, a little Wheaton terrier. And Sister Terry and I got to know Ticker and Kasha very well when we lived with her because they were part of the family.
Oh, Very sweet.
Isn't that sweet? Yes.
Yeah, I love this page. As we were preparing for this Benedictine conversation, I was surprised at the number of different types of artwork that Sister Molly did. And I have a few examples in here. And so as we move through it, according to what you've told me, she's done wall sculpture, painting, you know, just calligraphy, pottery and tile work, sculpture, sketching, wood sketches, or what do you call them? Woodcuts. Woodcuts, yeah. So we have a few to share with you. And Meredith and Sister Lois, if you could just kind of fill us in. This is actually two different pictures. And so the top one, and that's Sister Mary Charles standing there, right? So if you could talk to us about what she's standing in front of here.
She's standing in front of the facade of the Duluth Entertainment Center. Excuse me. She was commissioned to do this. It is entitled The Water Tree Rock. She did it in 1966.
Wow.
It is comprised of 24 variously textured panels of gray granite, depicting abstracted nature forms. And even today, this work remains fresh, and it's complementing the faceted geometry of the original auditorium building. This commission really brought Sister Mary Charles to the attention of a broad, local, and beyond local audience. And it's still there as fresh as the day it was.
So you can go down to the deck, to the convention center, and look at her work. And then the picture below is a clay representation that they presented her with.
Right.
I believe these are deck, the convention center officials that gave it to her. Yeah, that's amazing, truly amazing.
Did you, Meredith, did you have anything to say about that one, the facade?
No, no.
You didn't anything, okay.
No.
So, Sister Lois, I think if you could tell us what this is.
Oh, it's such a beautiful, this was her thesis that she did when she got her master's in fine arts from the University of Notre Dame. Mm-hmm. And she did it having in mind that it would go to the college dining room, because she taught before she moved over to the barn. She was a chair actually of the art department here at the College of St. Scholastica. So she did this beloved sculptured piece for the college, and for years it hung in a very vulnerable place where students going by could kind of, you know, like in Rome, kissing the feet of St. Peter until it is worn down. Well, people would tickle the toes and so forth, and it was clay. So she had to do some repair work after a while. But so then it was moved to a safer place. It's still in a dining room, but it's in the section called the Heritage Dining Room.
Oh, okay.
It's mounted on a beautiful brick wall. It's just gorgeous. So it's still there. Yeah.
And Michael Cohen, visited her in her studio when she was doing the sketch for this. She had finished the sketch and then she crumpled it up and threw it on the floor. And he said, "Oh, sister," he said, "that ought not to be on the floor." And she said, "Well, if you want it, you can have it." She took it home and it's framed.
Oh, this wow. The Last Supper. Yeah, lovely. Okay, another medium she worked in was with tiles. So tell us about this.
You want to do that one, Meredith?
No, you can.
Well, this is one that she did for Joel and Susie Rosenzweig, and it has many different expressions of their Jewish heritage, of their family history. They gave her the input, and then she created this booth. It's a tabletop. Now, is this one that's on top of one of those spools?
Probably.
Yeah, she'd retrieve these spools that were along the side of the road after the telephone company put in the new wires. Mm. And she'd get those big wooden spools. And so she created tabletops to go on top of those spools for people who, you know, who commissioned her to do one. So this is one she did for Joe and Susie Rosenzweig. Yes.
I see so many beautiful symbols in there, the menorah, mm-hmm. the Hanukkah menorah, and the Torah. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Just beautiful.
Really.
Meredith, you want to tell us about these?
Well, these are two of, I think, her earlier renditions of Saint Scholastica and Saint Benedict that she did by woodcut. And then she would run off prints on rice paper. And I think she wore out her arm doing that, actually, her shoulder. And that was one of the reasons that led her to doing iconography. It was, then she would, on the print, on the rice paper, she would take watercolor and put that on.
Okay. I really like these. Elie Wiesel, yes. Sister Lois.
Oh, so beautiful. This is another woodcut that she did. Elie Wiesel, I think we're familiar with him. You know, Sister Mary Charles really had a great, tender relationship with the Jewish community. And some of them became her closest friends, some of her closest friends and supporters and patrons. And so when Elie Wiesel was coming to be a lecturer at the temple, she was commissioned to do this woodcut depicting him, this beautiful, tender man. Oh, it's so powerful. It just doesn't almost bring tears to your eyes. We are all children of the same God and cannot stop living.
Yeah.
He was so pleased with the image, mom said, and deeply honored that how she depicted him.
Wow.
Of course, the star.
Such tenderness in his eyes. It's just captured there. It's absolutely beautiful.
Right.
And these next two, speak of her relationship with the Jewish community too. These Hasidic dancers are just, it's just spectacular. I love it. And then a Jewish wedding feast. Meredith, do you have anything to say about these? No?
No, just I love the movement and the energy in the history.
I think one of the things Molly said too was that the rich tradition of the Jewish people, just she said, lent themselves to the art that she did. Mm. These are two examples of that, I think. Yeah.
Beautiful. And then we have a woodcut of Saint Francis, and then this one on the right that's called Someday.
You know, I just love in the book Saved by Beauty, Peter Spooner wrote one of the essays, and he talks about these two. He had them side by side, and he says, I'm just going to read right from the book. He said, all of her artistic output alludes to themes of quietness and contemplation, reverence for nature, human beings, and the arts as a preeminent form of human and spiritual communion. Mm-hmm. She said, we can see this child rocking her little doll. We can see St. Francis next next door to this piece of art. And he said, "It just isn't it an example of how that same character and that same virtue and that same deep seeing and that same connection of all of life, and all of life is an expression of the holy. Here it is. Here it is. Isn't it precious?"
Sure is. Thank you. And then I believe there's a story behind this one too. The washing of the disciples' feet.
Right. I don't know the name of the priest, but he was a missionary to Africa. And he got in touch with Sister Mary Charles and asked her if she would do a woodcut for him, depicting Jesus washing the feet of the disciples. And so he was so touched when she did this one, showing Jesus as a Black Jesus, and disciples as Black men, Black disciples. Yeah, it just speaks of her big heart that saw everyone as part of the story of God's love. And it's just very beautiful.
It is. It's lovely. So then we move on to her iconography. And in the beginning of the section, the book that we keep referring to, everyone, is this book, Saved by Beauty. And this is also available along with the Rule of Benedict in the monastery gift shop. And it has tons and tons of her work in it. And I've just been captivated by it. We do have one comment from Natalie that I would love to share. Thank you for bringing her biography to being. Sister Doreen introduced me to it during a quiet day I spent at McCabe. It has been a gift to my heart and a continual confirmation of my own calling as an artist, as I too wrestled with thinking that artistry wasn't enough. God has taken me on a journey to see the very opposite, and I am thankful to have Sister Mary Charles's life and artwork to encourage me. Thank you for honoring her tonight. Thank you for your beautiful message, Natalie. That is lovely. Thank you. So in this book, Saved by Beauty, there's a whole section on Sister Mary Charles's icons. And it begins with this quote from you, Sister Lois, and Sister Terry Spindler. And I'm wondering if you could read this for us as we begin this section on icons.
I surely would be honored to. And then could I make a comment about the icon too?
Of course.
Okay. Maybe I'll do that first and then share the
sure
quote. I didn't say before, but Mary Charles was so committed, so grounded in our community, and so appreciative of the sisters, and shared with all of us, you know, her work, and invited us to the barn and just thought of things that she could create to be here at the monastery. And this is the depiction of the Annunciation, the angel Gabriel coming to Mary. And this one, she said, "I want to do an original icon of the Annunciation for my sisters." So this is an original. We have it honored on the wall going to the chapel. It's right by the statues of Benedict and Scholastica. So she was very mindful that she was doing this for her sisters in the community. And we are so touched and grateful for it. Okay, so here's the reflection. "Stars dance with anticipation. The earth purrs at her approach. Children sing with adulation. We all join in her celebration. Happy day, O beautiful spirit, Molly of the icons.
Beautiful. I love the second line, the earth purrs at her approach. Wow. But did you and Sister Terry write this after she had crossed the veil about her? Oh. Well, let's look at some more of her icons. This one, the Annunciation, is, lovely. This is the Mother of Compassion, which I know was one of her favorites and is one of my favorites now because of the story behind it especially. And I'm wondering if you could share that story, Sister Lois or Meredith, one of you?
Go ahead, Sister Lois.
Well, this particular icon was one of the ones that I remember when I was at the barn, where she would invite Sister Terry and I up to give our input, to give our suggestions, whatever. And she was commissioned by St. Olaf's Church in Minneapolis to do a 7-foot icon of our Mother of Compassion. 7 foot up in her studio at the barn. And when it was all completed, and they came up at different times to just see the progress and were so thrilled. But when it was all completed, they brought this flat bed truck and they came and we had to get a forklift and open the window. She always called that window her fire escape. She had there was a forklift there where that took the bales of hay down. And she would get on that and come down if she had to get out of the barn in an emergency. But anyhow, we had to take out the window and they came from the monastery with a big machine and it was a beautiful experience.
Because it wouldn't fit. You couldn't get it out any other way.
Couldn't get it down her narrow steps and around the corner. So it had to go out the window and onto the truck.
As we talk about these large icons, she did, and she did many of them. She did 3 of them for 12 holy apostles. She did the Trinity, 6-foot one for St. Paul's Monastery. We have to mention that she had a friend, Gary Erickson, whom she called her apprentice. And he was the one that put together these large boards. And he would gesso them. And that's the undercoat for the icon painting. Mm-hmm. And then he'd take his big power sander and go over the whole thing. So they were quite the pair. But she couldn't have done that later work without him.
Mm. Because I think you've told me as we've conversed that her work with icons was really toward the end of her life. It became her focus within the world of art. Is that correct?
Yes. I saw a clear and definite transformation in her artwork after she got back from Ligonier, Pennsylvania, studying iconography. In iconography, the icon is painted so that the light comes from within, and you can see this around the face of the mother and child here. And it's meant to depict God's presence within us, mm-hmm. emanating from us. And I saw her art as transformed when she started doing these icons. It was as if her own radiant spirit was undergoing a beautiful transformation.
Hmm.
And icons, for those who don't know it, are described as being written because they're intended to communicate a connection between the divine presence, God's saints, his mother. And gazing on an icon can bring you into a sacred encounter. So this was really a very spiritual practice for her.
Here's an icon on your left with Saint Scholastica, and on the right, Saints Benedict and Scholastica. I'm struck in this one on the right with how young they are. It's beautiful.
She did that on purpose.
Yeah.
Yeah. Can I tell my Lazarus story?
Of course.
In her classes, there was a number. I was one of her many icon students. Mm-hmm. And, she, after she finished really teaching classes, a number of us students would come to help her, or to come to paint under her in the studio. And during that last year of her life, her apprentice died a year before her, Gary, and she needed some help. This was in 2006. And so I would come down to paint with her or under her, but I would end up doing all these art chores that Gary might have been doing. And then it would be time for lunch, and I'd have to put out a little lunch for her. Well, on one of these occasions, I brought my painting of Lazarus coming forth from the tomb. And she said to me, "Meredith," she said, "if you don't get going on that icon, Lazarus is never going to get out of the tomb." Again, her Irish humor.
Yes. This is Our Lady of Korsun. And we are getting close to time, so I'm going to have to move through these kind of quickly. I'd love to spend a lot of time on each one. This one is just so beautiful. Mother of the Cosmos, Platyterra, is that right, Meredith? Platyterra? Okay. I love this one because you've got the universal Christ right there between her arms. It's beautiful.
And this is the Trinity that she wrote for St. Paul's Monastery.
St. Paul, okay.
And it's 6 feet high.
Wow.
It's just luminous. If you see the real, and it's hanging in their refectory, their dining room.
Wow.
It's just so luminous.
And they treasure it. They just absolutely treasure it.
I love it because it's so, there's something very casual about it, you know, just very approachable. Yeah, beautiful. And this is Transfiguration.
Yes, Molly did this 2 years before she died. Mm-hmm. She always wanted to do an icon of the Transfiguration, but she said, "I don't feel ready yet." Mm. I don't feel ready. And so I think as she got nearer to her time of leaving this world, she became ready. Mm. And so here is this beautiful icon that came from her beautiful, beautiful soul. Yeah. Mm.
Thank you for that. And now we move on just briefly to the book that was put together after her death. So I wonder if one of you could just talk about just briefly how the book came about, because you were both involved in it. So if you could just tell us a little bit about that.
Well, as I remember it, some of us were talking together about, wouldn't it be a good thing to collect her works and honor her by doing a book about her artwork and her life. And so there were six people who worked on it. My husband, John Schifsky, wrote many, if not most, of the chapters of the book. Sister Lois wrote something. Peter Spooner wrote a chapter. Vicki Siders and Andy Thierne and myself, we all worked as a team from, I think it was about 2011 to 2014 together. We met regularly, and it was such an honor. It was such an honor.
And along with that, that's wonderful, Meredith. Along with that, Peter, I believe it was Peter Spooner who was archiving her work, who had this thought, we should have an exhibit of hers. He was a guest curator at the Tweed Museum here in University of Minnesota. And he said, we should see if we can arrange for an exhibit of her work. So anyhow, he worked on that and we worked on that with him, and it was all arranged. So June 3rd of 2014 to September, I think 21st of 2014, I think it was mostly her icons and her woodcuts, am I right, Meredith? Mm-hmm. That were on display, that were in the exhibit, because we couldn't do everything. But anyhow, I was there for that whole time. And I think we were really motivated to get that book finished because we wanted to have it to be part of the exhibit. Mm-hmm. And of course, because they do sell it at their gift shop as well, I believe, or they did.
Their gift shop, okay.
But of course, we know it's here.
I'd like to read some words that my husband wrote as we come to our conclusion. He said in one of his chapters, she still nurtures us. Her artwork hangs in homes, churches, schools, hospitals, institutions across the country, and thousands of people have found joy and insight and inspiration in her work. So she's still nurturing us.
She is.
So as we conclude, I'd just like to share another quote of Sister Molly's. She wrote, "It took many years in community before I regarded my gift of art as ministry," which is what you were talking about earlier, both of you. "Somehow the paintings, carvings, and printmaking seemed self-serving and not nearly as important to the world as nursing the sick, educating youth, administering hospitals, and the like. The question always haunted me, am I really touching anyone's life?" So, as we conclude tonight, I'd like to invite both of you to, you know, she obviously touched people's lives and continues to touch people's lives. What is it that you really want people to remember about Sister Molly? What is it that you'd like to leave us with tonight? Meredith, you want to start?
No, Sister Lois, start.
Okay. Well, I thought about this a lot, and I actually have several things. First of all, I believe she would really want us to nurture our relationship with the God who dwells in our deepest center, because she did that, and look what happened, and look how we're blessed by that. Be true to your deepest longing, the deepest longings of your heart, and know that you yourself are a work of art, fashioned by God's creative love to bring forth the good and the true and the beautiful in who you are and in all you give and do. Let all your work flow from your spiritual center, where God's creative spirit is at work, so that our human family and our beloved earth community will be healed and made whole. I really believe that's what she would say to us today, because her life spoke that, her work spoke that. And as Meredith said, they continue to do that.
Yeah, I do believe that her belief was that beauty heals. And this might be a quote from her or someone who wrote in the book, but it is a world where beauty, truth, and goodness give us a glimpse of the God who dwells within and yet beyond all creation. And she would want us to trust that creative spark in each of our spirits and how that connects us to the God within.
Beautiful. Tonight's conversation has been one that is almost iconic, that we could spend a lot of time with. And I want to let everyone know that within a day or two, our assistant, Jean Anderson, usually has the recorded version up on our archive page. So if you do want to see it again, you can access it on our website. I want to thank you, Meredith, so much for being here and sharing this love for Sister Mary Charles with us. Thank you. Thank you so much, and for all you do. And Sister Lois, your beautiful words and the lovely memory that you bring to us of Sister Mary Charles. I never had the privilege of meeting her, but I feel like I know her through so many things that you've said and that you've said, Meredith, and through just experiencing some of her artwork. So I really want to thank you both for being here.
Thank you.
Yeah. And thank you to all of you out there for participating in our Benedictine Conversations. We break for the summer, like I said at the beginning, and we hope to see you back here in September. On behalf of the Sisters of St. Scholastica and the Center for Spirituality and Enrichment, which is a ministry of the Sisters of St. Scholastica, we thank everyone here for being here with us tonight, and we wish you and your loved ones peace and blessings and a wonderful summer. Thank you all. Good night.